Nevertheless, it's consistent to assume that there's a unique way of obtaining this decoration. So, of course, the simplest example is a single loop. And then there's exactly one way to decorate this graph, and that's by the Quine atom. Now, of course, it turns out that, and this is one of the difficulties of the subject, the same set can arise at the distinguished point of several different pointed graphs. So this is something that has to be emphasized from the start. So suppose I have an infinite descent. Well, that's a pointed graph. Let's take the point to be here at the top. And I have the condition that at each level, the decoration of the point Qn is the set containing the decoration of the next point down. So that would be the requirement of a decoration. Well, if you think about it for a second, the only way that you can decorate this infinite descent is to assume that at each point you assign the Quine atom. Because Quine atom located at every single one of these nodes will satisfy this relationship at every node. Okay, so the only solution is to take Qn dQn to be equal to omega for every n. So in this case, there are two radically different pictures for discussion of the Quine atom. And in fact, you can show without much more work that any pointed graph that has no external legs must be decorated completely by the Quine atom. It's a simple exercise. Yes.
In the axiom of antifoundation, you say any pointed graph, lemma, you mean so finite and infinite graph, or what kind of graph you are considering?
Okay, so as I've indicated, it should be a directed graph.
Yes.
And it can be either finite or infinite. In fact, in Aczel's presentation, graph is just a purely set theoretical notion. No, you have a set of nodes and a set of edges. So there's no restriction.
Okay.
Now, so that this is not circular, you probably should begin with graphs that are formulated in well-founded set theory. And then from there on, go to decorations of such graphs, and then obtain sets which are non-well-founded. I hope that answers your question. All right, well, what could this possibly have to do with consciousness? Well, I think what's clear in Aczel is that he's interested in the notion of self-reference. And this is a step towards bringing consciousness into play. So, for example, this infinite chain is an infinite regression of self-reference. Or you might have this more complicated example.
In your original definition of decoration, is the statement supposed to be that the decoration of each point Q is the set of decorations of the children of Q?
Yeah. Yeah. I think that what I've written is imprecise. Yeah. Yeah. So should be, let's write it as the set of DR such that R is a child of Q. Yeah, that's certainly what I meant to write. Yeah. So that should be applied here as well, right? Yeah, so then I think that makes things more consistent. And so this symbol simply means that there exists an edge going from Q to the node R. All right, well, where did self-reference first come up in set theory? It came up in the formulation of the Russell paradox. Russell paradox actually appeared just around the turn of the century, the end of the 19th century. In a letter that Russell wrote to Frege, who was just about to come out with a massive book on the foundations of mathematics. And this one-page letter demolished Frege's hopes of publishing that book. It also led to considerable rethinking of mathematics over a period of 20, 30 years, until foundations of mathematics were thought to be well understood. So what does the paradox deal with? Well, it deals with something that I would call the Russell set, which I'll call N. And this is the collection of all sets X such that X is not an element of X. All right, so if it's possible for a set to be an element of itself, it's also possible for it to not be an element of itself. So you have these two possibilities to grapple with. And by the law of the excluded middle, we divide all sets into two types. His terminology was that if a set is not an element of itself, it's normal. If it is an element of itself, it's abnormal. Okay. So why do I have to put these quotation marks? So the paradox is that N is itself paradoxical. And that's because N, an element of N, implies N is not an element of N. And on the other hand, N, not an element of N, implies N is an element of N.